In this lecture, we'll take a look at what an annuity due is and also individual retirement accounts. So we have two types of annuities. We have ordinary annuity where the payments are made at the end of each period. And then we have an annuity due where the payments are made at the beginning of the period. Because the money is being deposited earlier in the account, the interest is going to be greater in an annuity due because the fact that the money is in there longer. Versus an ordinary annuity, that money is, nothing is happening in the account until that payment is made, so there is no interest growing until the payment is made. Let's see how we calculate an annuity due. We're going to use our annuity table that we had before, but we have some slight adjustments. The first step that we need to do is to add 1 to the number of compounding periods. And the reason we do that is because in an annuity due, that payment is made at the beginning. So it's like this money was in there right at the start, which it is, and needs additional interest calculations, and adding 1 compensates for that using the same table as an ordinary annuity. Then we do business as usual, multiply the table value by the periodic deposit, but that's going to overestimate the amount that's actually in the account by 1 payment. So to compensate that for that, we have 1 more step, and what we will do is we will subtract 1 payment from this amount. Let's see how this works. They're asking us to compute the amount of an annuity due and the amount of interest earned for $9,500 deposited semi-annually at 4% compounded semi-annually for 9 years. It's compounding semi-annually, that's twice per year for 9 years. So normally if this was an ordinary, we would have 18. Because it's an annuity due, we will add 1 to that number. 18 plus 1 gives us 19. We have to have this 1 more value on our N. Because of the nature of an annuity due, this amount of money is in there earning interest virtually a whole period, in this case, half a year longer than if it was an ordinary annuity. Then we go to the table. We have to calculate our I, interest rate per compounding period, so it's 4% divided by the frequency, which is twice a year for our compounding, giving us a 2%. That gives us the multiplier shown here. We multiply that by the regular deposit, giving us annuity value, but we're not done. There weren't 19 payments made. We had to bump up our number of compounding periods to compensate for the interest growth of depositing the money early. However, there were only 18 payments when it was all said and done. So we will subtract $9,500 off from our value to give us the true value that's in the account at the end of the 9 years. How much interest is earned? We need to determine the total deposits. $9,500 times 18 gives us this amount. We will then subtract that from the value of the annuity, and the difference leaves us with the interest that this account has grown during the 9 years. Let's look at another one. They're asking us to compute the amount of the annuity due and the amount of interest earned if $3,800 is deposited quarterly at 8% compounded quarterly for 3 years. We'd need to determine our I and our N to use our annuity table. However, because this is an annuity due and the deposits are made early, we need to add 1 to our number of compounding periods. It's compounded quarterly per year for 3 years, for an ordinary would be 12, but our first step for an annuity due is to add 1 to our N. Next, we will find the intersection of compound interest per period and our number of compounding periods plus 1 from the table, multiply that by the regular deposit, but we're not done. We overstated the number of compounding periods to compensate for the time that the money is in there to get the correct amount of interest. But our overstatement is in saying that there were actually 13 payments, when in reality there were only 12 deposits of $3,800. So our last step, the third step for calculating an annuity due, is to subtract off that overstatement of 1 payment. This then would be the amount of the annuity, and to calculate the interest, we need to determine how much money was actually deposited in there. 12 deposits of $3,800 gives us a total deposit of $45,600. Then, to calculate the interest, we'll take our amount of the annuity, subtract the total deposits, leaving with a difference which represents the interest. Let's do one more quick review. They're asking us to calculate or compute the amount of annuity due and the interest earned on $10,200 deposited quarterly at 10% compounded quarterly for 5 years. We need to find the I and the N, the interest rate per compounding period. So we take the interest rate divided by 4 because of quarterly compounding periods. And the total number of compounding periods, 4 per year for 5 years, gives us 20. And because it's an annuity due, we add 1 because the money is growing for essentially an extra period because of being deposited at the beginning of the compound period. We find the value from the table that corresponds with our I and our N, multiply it by our regular deposit, and our third step in calculating an annuity due then is to subtract off 1 of those payments because of our overstatement to get the correct amount of interest earned. So at the end of 5 years, this is what our annuity, the amount of the annuity is. To calculate the interest, we need to determine how much was totally deposited. 20 payments of $10,200 subtracted from the amount of the annuity will leave us with a difference of the interest. Annuities show up with employment oftentimes. Jobs or employers will make contributions into annuities for retirement plans. There's multiple types of retirement plans. We have, the government has associated numbers with certain types of plans. A 401k, for example, are for people working in the private sector. 403b retirement plans are for employees of public schools and certain tax-exempt organizations. When an employer makes a contribution, they are taking money from your paycheck before taxes are calculated. And some plans will, or employers will, also contribute to that amount. And the good news is that there is no tax taken out at the time of this money being invested into these retirement plans. So there's already growth from the fact that it's not being reduced by the tax rate for the individual. Another type of retirement account is something that an individual can set up. It's called an individual retirement account, or an IRA, through a bank or some kind of brokerage firm. We have two types of IRA. One is called a traditional IRA, and it's tax deductible the year that the money is deposited into it. It will grow income free as that interest is compounded until it's withdrawn. For example, putting $5,000 into a traditional IRA today can reduce your tax obligation today, the federal and state combined, of perhaps even $1,000 or more. Keeping in mind that when this money put into this account is withdrawn, then you would be subject to tax on that deposit that was made into it. So this is acting like an annuity, something that you're making regular deposits to, and then building it up, and once we're retired, taking regular payments off from it. And the idea is, with the traditional IRA, that once an individual is retired, that perhaps they're in a lower tax bracket, and so the tax obligation on this amount of money will be a lower amount. One thing to remember about an IRA is that the money that's deposited there cannot be withdrawn until you reach the age of 59 and a half, unless you incur one of the following: a disability, death, expensive medical treatment, taking out a loan for a first home, or if you are borrowing against it for college expenses for your children. If these don't occur and some financial calamity has happened, there is a stiff penalty for taking money out of an IRA before reaching that designated age. There is another type of IRA. It's called a Roth IRA. And the difference between a Roth and a traditional: in a Roth, when you contribute to the account, that deposit has taxes calculated on it. You've paid the taxes on that income that is being deposited into the account. The good news is that the tax obligation has been met. That deposit, as well as the interest compounded through the life of this IRA until you start withdrawing, is going to grow tax-free. So that when you take the withdrawals at 59 and a half, they are not subject to income taxes.